Back in 1965, Steve Carlton came to his first major league camp. He was 10-1 at Winnipeg the year before. And the most dominant trait of Lefty at that time was his Adam's apple. He was so thin and so tall. And obviously, he was to fill out and become one of the strongest guys that I've ever met, pound for pound. But he was, in a very quiet way, very, very cocky, very self-assured, very confident. But a lot of people didn't know it because he rarely said anything. Well, on about our second outing, I think Steve had gone about four innings. Now, keep in mind that the year before, the Cardinals were world champions. I had a good series, and you know, we were pretty confident ourselves that spring. Well, I'm in there shaving, Kenny Boyer's here, Dick Groat's here, and I hear footsteps behind me, and it's the tall guy with the dominant trait as the Adam's apple. He's standing behind me, and he kind of swallows. He goes, and he was a little nervous. He said, tapped me on the shoulder, and saw him through the mirror, and I, you know, got shaving cream about halfway off my face, and he said, "You've got to call more breaking balls behind in the count." And I went crazy. I snapped. I said, "What? Who are you to tell me? I mean, what kind of success have you had? You're telling me that I've got to call more breaking balls? I mean, what gives you the right to say?" Well, we stood toe-to-toe, and I'm looking up, naturally. I mean, at that time, I wasn't but 23 years old. Steve was 21, and all the veterans on the ball club were laughing at the situation, and I guess now I can laugh about it, and certainly Lefty can too.
Tim McCarver had a great knack of getting close to pitchers and young pitchers, but he and Tim had their fallings out for sure, especially in the first part of Steve's career, because Steve is a very headstrong person, and he makes up his mind to do something, or the way he's going to do it, he doesn't deviate from it very much. And of course, McCarver's about the same, so you have two hardheads knocking against concrete there.
We were both very impressionable at that time, and we had a lot of great teachers in the Cardinal organization, and the players were so good. Dick Groat, Bill White, Kenny Boyer, Julian Javier, Kurt Flood, Bob Gibson. Gibson was quite a force. And Lefty always said that the mound was Bob Gibson's office, that when hitters made outs, they didn't come back through. You know, Pete Rose used to try to intimidate pitchers, especially young pitchers. He'd make an out, and then he'd run across the mound, and even at times make the pitcher move. They never did that with Gibson. And Steve said, you know, that's the way I should handle myself. And when I get a little success, that's what's going to be. Nobody's going to come in my office, and nobody did. He got in a few kitchens, but nobody came in his office.
When I was young, I was frightened to throw inside, and you're afraid about hit guys. And Timmy always had me knock guys down at the right time. And if a guy was really hurting the ball club, I mean, you straighten him up or, you know, knock, push him back. But you'd get it in there. He'd sit behind the hitter where I couldn't see him, you know, so I had to throw at the hitter.
When you're looking at him and see him out on the mound, you know, he was a tall guy, very imposing, you know, and when he threw, you know, his arm would almost look like it was right in your face, you know.
One of my great stories about Steve Carlton is with my good friend, the Hall of Famer here at Red Shaney's. When Steve first came up, Red would say, get what's his name up there? Tall Boy, get Tall Boy up. And he called him Tall Boy for about the first 2 weeks. And then after Steve showed him his stuff, he'd get Steve Carlton up, please.